Alrighty. Well, I went to a gig last night, and I'm going to sound a little bit like a fan because I seem to know stuff, but I'm really not. I'm really not a huge fan, as in I like this guy's material. I just don't know his back catalogue particularly well. That's him on the speaker now, on my Google speaker. Stephen Cummings is his name, and here is his latest album. I bought that off Stephen last night. Prisoner of Love. I had heard the album before on Spotify, but he was selling it after the gig, so I thought, okay, well, better buy the vinyl. So I'm a bit of a vinyl collector these days. I had the option of Prisoner of Love, the latest album, or it's the latest album of new material. He's just released a retrospective with about 50-odd songs on it, which I've also listened to on Spotify, and yeah, really, really liked it. However, I'm a bit of a purist in this respect, so I paid $25 for the Prisoner of Love album. I couldn't tell you any of the tracks on this except one. And that one, my God, that is it blows everything else out of the water. The song is called The Wind Blew Hard. Last track on side one. I found it last year when I was compiling my top 10 songs of 2019. And it came in at number two on my worldwide polling of best songs, in my opinion. It came in second only to Sturgill Simpson's Mercury in Retrograde, which if you've heard that song or the album it came from, Sound and Fury, you'd appreciate just what a giant killer that song was. But yeah, The Wind Blew Hard by Stephen Cummings, bloody fantastic song. Second, in my opinion, for the best songs of last year. Now, I'm not sure if it was last year or the year before, but Stephen Cummings actually retired from music, and Prisoner of Love was basically a return to it because obviously retirement didn't take. I mean, he's getting on a bit. I don't know how old Stephen actually is, but I saw him 10 years ago, and he was pushing probably 60 then, so I'm guessing he's around 70-odd now. I went and saw him 10 years ago at the Mission to Seafarers in Melbourne. Wasn't a music venue particularly, but he just was him and a guitarist at the front of the this function room. Maybe 20 or 30 people sitting around listening to them. And it was just a really, really cool show. The formula hasn't changed. Last night was the same thing. Stephen picking up his 12-stringed acoustic occasionally. And he was backed the entire night by a solo guitar player who just sort of noodled around on an electric guitar. It wasn't a Gibson 335, but it looked for all the world like one. Just didn't have the double horns at the top. So if I saw it again, I'd probably be able to tell you what the model was, but I couldn't quite see the brand from my seat. I was only about 3 metres from the stage, which shows just how bad my eyes are without glasses. So, anyway, Stephen Cummings, good show, really enjoyed it. He's out of retirement temporarily, doing about 6 shows around the country. If you get a chance, go and see him. And if you want to listen to the album, please do. Good album. The Wind Blew Hard, amazing song. What else have I done this week? Well, I had a week off because Sunday night I was up in Sydney. And the reason I was up in Sydney was because there was a massive concert on at ANZ Stadium. I went to the Firefight Australia concert. And the Firefight Australia concert had all sorts of Australian luminaries from the music industry. Just to run through a few, I'm going to start with, actually, the order on the back of the shirt is pretty as good as any to go with. Don't know how they chose the order, it's probably just what fonts work best and how the image worked, but let's go with the fact that the first act is an Australian band, a bunch of young blokes in their early 20s, 5 Seconds of Summer. Now, 5 Seconds of Summer, from memory, I wrote them off as a bit of a boy band a few years ago. I think they were on a Coca-Cola commercial or a Sprite commercial or some sort of advert on TV, about 3 or 4 years ago now, actually, now I've said that. But I thought they sounded okay, but wasn't about to go out and buy any of their albums. Unbeknownst to me, they're still around, and they played in between I think it was between Alice Cooper and Queen, who Queen with Adam Lambert also played this event. Might have the orders a bit mixed up here. They might have been before Alice Cooper. Anyway, whatever they were, 5 Seconds of Summer, their latest single, name of which escapes me for the minute, is bloody amazing. Their new album is coming out in about another month's time, and I'm going to get onto that on Spotify, of course. I'll go and see them if they tour Australia. I get the impression they're not going to be playing small little venues like Stephen Cummings is doing at the moment, because these guys just slayed 70,000 people at ANZ Stadium. I looked up their website. They're touring the US, the UK at the moment. It's a bit of an indictment on the Australian music industry that I really hadn't heard much of them, except the fact that they were on a soft drink commercial a few years ago. They are really good. Much as it sounds weird to say this, I get a very Viola Beach vibe from them. The music doesn't sound the same. Viola Beach, of course, were a Britpop act that were cut tragically short many years ago. I just hope the same thing doesn't happen to 5 Seconds of Summer, of course. Yeah, a bunch of young blokes, as I say, good with their instruments. Great voice, great songwriting. Really, really enjoyed it. Probably the highlight for me of the show for the reasons I just raised. Alice Cooper is next on the t-shirt. Good gig by Alice Cooper. People loved it. I've never seen Alice Cooper live, never really listened to his music. Everyone played like 15 minutes. So Alice Cooper played three or four. I think he did, might have done four because he's a bigger name. Poison, he did Poison, that's the song I recognise from the 80s. School's Out for Summer, or called something like that, I guess. Didn't recognise the first couple of songs. Bloody awesome set. Amazing guitarist as well. That's what I was going to talk about. His lead guitarist, or one of his guitarists, is a lady named Nita Strauss. And I saw her interviewed on a rig rundown on YouTube a little while ago. She's got a signature guitar by Ibanez. Great player. That guitar made me sort of think, oh, maybe I need to consider an Ibanez guitar. I've always been Fenders and Epiphones and Washburns and that sort of thing. Ibanez is about as far from my style of music as you can get, but honestly, she rocked that thing. Did an amazing job. Just keep going, shall we? Work down the list. Third on the list. This isn't the order they played in, of course. Amy Shark. Amy Shark released an album a couple of years ago. She's a Gold Coast singer, and she is bloody fantastic. The album got rave reviews. I'm going to say it was either March last year or around October, November 2018. I want to say March last year. I just remember hearing about awards that she'd won in Australia for her music. And so I started playing it a few times on Spotify. Won't lie, I'm probably not going to go and see her specifically again. I'm not going to go out and buy her album, I don't think, at this point. That said, her next album might be even better than the last one. And the last one was pretty damn good. So, good show, good gig. Thank you, Amy Shark. Baker Boy. Baker Boy was the surprise. Baker Boy is a rapper from Darwin. Rap or hip-hop, I get the two mixed up a little bit. I like them both, as in rap and hip-hop. I don't know where one ends and one begins, unfortunately. But what Baker Boy did was bloody fantastic. Kicking myself a little bit, I'd never heard of the guy. Did a bit of research and found out that he's won various awards and things, and he works with Indigenous Australians up in Darwin and helping young kids find their way into the music industry. Seems like a hell of a nice guy and very, very entertaining. Unfortunately, here's my only whinge about Firefight Australia, is that they didn't have pass outs. Now, the whole gig was 10 and a half hours. I'd bought a gold seat because there's no way in hell I was going to be able to stand up at my age and my state of health, whatever else. I wasn't going to be able to stand up for like 10 and a half hours in a mosh pit. So I paid the extra and booked a seat. Hard plastic things in the stadium for like football games where people spend a few hours here and there. Up and down to the bar a few times, of course. But 10 and a half hours of music, 70,000 people, and no pass outs. I couldn't sit in that stadium for that period of time. So I looked at the schedule and worked out when it is that I actually wanted to turn up to the gig. I would have gone in earlier and I would have seen Baker Boy, but since there were no pass outs, I didn't go in until about 6 p.m. Concert started at about 1 o'clock. And it finished about 11. So I did the last half, basically. Where was I going with that? Anyway, the reason I didn't see Baker Boy in person was that I was sitting right outside the stadium at a bar called The Locker Room, where the telecast of the show was being played on a big screen TV. So I sort of stood there, had a couple of beers, watched the big screen performance of Baker Boy. Daryl Braithwaite was another one I watched on the big screen, and Grinspoon. I think they are the three I watched at the bar. But yeah, long story short, Baker Boy, bloody fantastic. I want to go and see him perform, but unfortunately, the next few gigs appear to be festivals. Hell, I'll travel interstate to go and see a solo gig, or even if he's supporting someone. Very, very keen to see him perform live. Conrad Sewell, I'm a letdown to the music industry right now. Apparently he did a great, great gig. Whether it's still up on YouTube, I don't know. Apparently Conrad Sewell blew them away. I just didn't see it, unfortunately, because I was walking between my hotel room and the bar when Conrad Sewell was on. Daryl Braithwaite, talked about Daryl Braithwaite before. Saw him play in Cairns about, must have been 5 years ago, maybe? 5 or 6 years ago. He blew them away at Firefight Australia. He really did. Played his classic song, Horses. I think One Summer was his opening track. The second one, the one in the middle, was something else equally famous in the Australian music industry, but I can't remember what it was, because even after the gig, when a lot of these things were getting put up on YouTube, Daryl's set wasn't up there. Just one song, Horses. Oh, that song in the background there is The Wind Blew Hard by Stephen Cummings. I was telling you about. I'm getting sidetracked. I'm getting very sidetracked. I'll turn Stephen down.
There we go.
So Daryl Braithwaite, Delta Goodrum, she was on stage when I got to the venue at about 6-ish. Delta Goodrum, always good value, people love her. Look, she's very, very talented. She's just never been my cup of tea. But yeah, she did a great set by all accounts. I saw most of it. Delta Goodrum. Grinspoon, I'd never seen them live before. Chemical Bomb was their Chemical Bomb, Chemical Heart. I'm going to say Chemical Bomb was their big song, and they opened up with that on the set. Grinspoon again is a bar, a band I saw at the bar. I think I've seen the lead singer in solo mode. Well, he was part of a Beatles tribute maybe 10 years ago, I think. But anyway, Grinspoon. Great set, really enjoyed what I saw. Guy Sebastian, say what you will. I've never been a massive fan of Guy Sebastian, the Australian Idol winner of about 10 years ago. Australia's entrant in the Eurovision Song Contest a couple of years ago, the first time we were invited to perform. Look, he's got a great voice, great sense of music. He's someone that I just don't know why I don't like particularly, but I can certainly appreciate massive amount of talent and why Australia has fallen in love with him over the years. Hilltop Hoods. I've seen them a few times now. They were one of the support acts for Eminem, bang on 12 months ago, in fact, at the same venue. So could have even been the same night. Actually, hold that thought. I just remembered something. Talk amongst yourselves there, ladies and gentlemen. It'll be worth it, trust me. I knew I had this somewhere. Eminem, my concert ticket from the Rapture Tour 2019. And so it was the 16th of March was when Firefight Australia was on at ANZ Stadium. Let's have a look what date Eminem was on. Friday the 22nd of February. Did I say March before? I meant February. I said February, I meant February. Didn't mean March. Friday 22nd of February, which is 1 year tomorrow, Saturday. So, I was at Eminem and one of the support acts, as well as Royce da 5'9", was the Hilltop Hoods, or just Hilltop Hoods. I don't know why my voice just went up in pitch then. I said Hoods. Anyway, Hilltop Hoods. I've been a fan of the Hoods for, God, pretty 20 odd years. I mean, I can't be right. Anyway, the Nosebleed Section was their big breakthrough on Triple J. Bought their CDs for a couple of years. Really like their stuff. Australian hip hop at its finest. Not rap. This is, I mentioned before about where hip hop begins and rap ends and vice versa. Hilltop Hoods are well and truly hip-hop. Really enjoy their stuff. Always a good show. I think I've only ever seen them as a support act. I don't think I've ever been to a headliner of the Hilltop Hoods. But, yeah, I would have seen them 3 or 4 times over the years. Next one. How are we going for time? 17 minutes. This is quite good. Quite enjoying this walk down memory lane. Next one, Ice House, Australian mainstay of many years, biggest back in the 80s, of course. Their Man of Colours album was huge. Their song Great Southern Land was on the Young Einstein soundtrack, and everybody in Australia, as soon as that song starts up, we go off into a far away place that is just amazing. Great Southern Land and Ice House open with it. Ivor Davies, he's still got it. They're still touring. 70,000 people, ANZ Stadium, opening with a didgeridoo being played by a chap named something Barton. It's terrible. William Barton, there we go, it's on the t-shirt. Opened with the didgeridoo, then along comes Ice House and they went straight into Great Southern Land. It was sublime. Then I think they went into Electric Blue, and I confess that's when I left the venue because I didn't want to deal with the crowd exiting. Most of the crowd, well, not most, actually it's a lie, some of the crowd had already left because Queen and Adam Lambert, they went on about 8 o'clock, 10 past 8, and that was why a lot of people were there, to see Queen and Adam Lambert. So the exodus was quite noticeable as soon as that part of the show finished. Which is a shame, because those people that left missed out on some really, really amazing acts. So, Ice House, fantastic work. Once again, I'd go and see them. I'll go and see them in solo mode, but they're playing at a festival down the road from me in March. Don't really want to go to the festival. Don't want to go and spend a couple of $100 on a ticket or whatever it is, and stand out in the sun just to see one act that I like. Not a fan of festivals, you might gather that. Illy, I missed entirely. I don't recall why. I think it was because I'd gone back to the hotel, had a shower, got my bag, got my camera, just decided to have a quick rest before going to the show itself. I've been on the go since about 5 o'clock that morning, taking the train up to Sydney, and yeah, just wanted a little bit of downtime. So Illy I missed, unfortunately. I think I probably had the TV on at the time. Actually, no, he might have, I don't know. I missed him anyway. Jessica Malboy, missed her as well. She did make an appearance at one point. I could see her from my seat. She went out to the front of her corporate box, waved at the crowd, and the crowd went apeshit waving back at it. So, yeah, Jessica Malboy, Australian mainstay once again. Illy, Australian rapper. Great, great artists in their own right. I just don't know much about them. John Farnham, what can you say? Closed the gig out at about 11-ish, along with Olivia Newton-John. He sang You're the Voice, I think. He sang Age of Reason. I'd never seen John Farnham. Actually, maybe I had. You know, I think I did. I reckon, because I went to a thing called Sound Relief about, 2009 in Melbourne. And that was a similar sort of thing. It was to raise funds for fire and flood victims after the 2009 disasters. And I reckon John Farnham might have closed that concert out. Interesting, you know, think about it, but most of the artists here are a different set of artists from 2009. In 2009, remember Augie March, Midnight Oil in Melbourne at the MCG. There was talk about doing another Sound Relief concert on a similar sort of scale, but I don't know whether the promoters decided one was enough, the Firefight Australia gig was going to just destroy all before it, and there was no point doing another one. I don't know what the deal was. Anyway, John Farnham, he turned up with Olivia Newton-John. She came out of retirement, speaking of Stephen Cummings. She came out of retirement, apparently, for this this gig. Still in very, very fine voice. The only screw-up, unfortunately, is John went in for a bit of a peck on the cheek when she was mid-note singing. So, yeah, the sound got a bit messed up when he did that. So, John, stop kissing Olivia Newton-John when she's trying to sing. Katie Lang. Jeez, how can I forget Katie Lang? She was amazing. She came up, she took the stage after Queen, for God's sake. So you got Queen comes out, does the same set they did at Live Aid, and the one that was sort of created in the movie, Bohemian Rhapsody. And Katie Lang comes out, and all you've got is she stands at the front of the stage by herself. In the background, there's a bloke on a grand piano, and she sings the song, title escapes me, I Would Walk in Good Company, or something like that. Beautiful gospel-y sort of song, followed by Hallelujah, her version of that, which is just sublime. I've been a Katie Lang fan for a long, long time. Don't follow her as much as I probably should. Songs from the 40-something Parallel, all these Canadian artists, love that album. Must be about 10 years ago, 15 years ago since that came out. But she did her two songs. Crying was the other song. That was a B-side to a Roy Orbison single from 1988, from memory. She duetted with Roy Orbison on the song Crying. Was it the B-side to You Got It? No, it wasn't. It was the B-side to, I think, The Only One. I'm going to say the song on the A-side was The Only One, and it was a bonus single that I got when I bought the, I'm starting to wonder now. Was it a bonus single when I bought the Mystery Girl album? I think it was. But I've got the single for You Got It as well, so I'm going to say, I'm getting off topic here. Mystery Girl was bundled with a 45 single of The Only One, which was a second single off of Mystery Girl. And the B-side of that was called Crying, duet between Katie Lang and Roy Orbison. There we go, the more you know. Lee Kernaghan, Australian country singer, he opened the show. Fine voice, people loved him. I just don't know much about the guy. as soon as he's on TV, you say, oh, there's Lee Kernaghan. But, yeah, ask me to name any of his songs. He's full country. He's basically, they say you should never go full country. Lee Kernaghan is full country in the Slim Dusty sort of style. Michael Bublé is a terrible who's who of artists. It's great. Michael Bublé, he was playing a gig down in Melbourne, and he wanted to be part of the performance or the Sound Relief Firefight, not Sound Relief, the Firefight Australia concert. So they did a live video link up to him for a couple of songs, because of course they have massive video displays behind the stage, so they piped Michael up from Melbourne. He did a couple of songs which, hate to say it, they kind of fell flat. They weren't like big songs as far as I know. He welcomed the Sydney feed, then he went into some back catalogue or B-sides or fillers, and then halfway through the third song, they decided to cut the feed. So he didn't even get... He did the introduction, said, oh yeah, g'day everybody in Sydney. I'm Michael Bublé, and I'm very proud to be part of the Firefight Australia concert. But he never got to say goodbye. I miss Michael Bublé. Olivia Newton-John. Peking Duck, another Australian act. Enjoyed what I saw of it. But once again, I was in transit between the hotel and the venue or something like that. Can't remember what. But yeah, Peking Duck, enjoyed what I saw. Not going to go looking for them, I'm afraid, to see again. But enjoyed it. Pete Murray, he had an amazing album about 10 years ago called Feeler. Not Feeler? I'm going to say it's called Feeler. Doesn't sound right, though. Anyway, whatever it was. Pete Murray, really, really good Australian artist. I'm surprised he's still around, I'll be honest. I just hadn't heard from him for a long time. So yeah, Pete Murray, good set. Queen and Adam Lambert just lifted the roof off the place, what can you say? I went and saw Adam Lambert about 10 years ago in Melbourne. He was is playing there in support of his For Your Entertainment album. I think it was like the year after he'd come second on American Idol. I think he came second. Kelly Clarkson got first. I don't know. I could be wrong on that, but I'm just going to say Kelly Clarkson got first, Adam Lambert got second, and now Adam Lambert is just a powerhouse of great vocals, great personality, great gig. There's not much I can say about the Queen gig that hasn't been said. Check it out on YouTube. It was fantastic. All 25 minutes of it. Queen had played at ANZ Stadium the night before, which is why they lent their setup for the whole concert here. So that was why there was no setting up of amps, speakers, video screens, etc. It was just all their kit from the night before. So thank you, Queen. Thank you, Adam Lambert. Very generous. Tina Arena. She's the second last one on the shirt. Look, Tina Arena has been around once again forever. Young talent time, I remember, was Tiny Tina Arena when I was growing up. She's someone who's never quite cut through to getting to the Kylie Minogue sort of level or anything like that. But there's no reason that she shouldn't have, particularly. Choice of songs, perhaps. I just don't know. Look, she'd be in her 40s now, pretty late 40s. Still a bundle of energy. And she's adjusting her catalogue for the sort of music someone of her age should be doing. Not entirely sure, the white T-shirt with the sparkly love heart on the front. And leaping around the stage like a 20-something-year-old works for Tina Arena. But, look, pleasant. I've always wanted to see her live. Now I have. I can draw a line under that. William Barton. He was the didgeridoo player that opened for Icehouse. apparently he's very, very big in the Indigenous music scene. I just can't comment. I don't know the guy. Didn't know who William Barton was. In fact, I was a bit worried at first that maybe, because it said Ice House and William Barton, I was afraid that Ivor Davies might not have been the lead singer of Ice House anymore, and I was a bit disappointed by that. But he was, and William Barton opened for them with a didgeridoo. Look, that's half an hour of me rabbiting on about Stephen Cummings and the Firefight Australia gig. That's pretty enough for me now. I will see you all soon.